In today's session, we are honored to have with us Mr. Li Jiange, who is the Vice Chairman of Central Huijin Investment Company, Chairman of the Board of Trustees of Sun Yefang Foundation. In this lecture, Ms. Li will discuss how China could address urbanization challenges while ensuring its economic goals and policy reforms on track. Today's lecture will begin with a presentation by Mr. Li, followed by a moderated discussion and a Q&A session with the audience, which will be moderated by Professor Deng Yongheng, Provost Chair Professor and Director of the Institute of Real Estate Studies at the National University of Singapore. The presentation and moderated discussion will be conducted in Mandarin with a consecutive interpretation in English by Ms. Chao Wanyi. Now, let us begin the session by inviting Mr. Li on stage for his presentation. Ms. Li, please.
谢谢各位来宾，感谢这个新加坡城市宜居中心和新加坡国立大学的邀请，趁我在到新加坡来参加那个新加坡Summit以及那个大马锡的国际委员会的会议期间呢，顺便到这里来给大家讲一讲我对城市化的一点点认识。那么我今天讲的这个内容呢， 是城市化、全球趋势和中国问题。我讲这个题目的意思是说，城市化既是一个全球的整个人类的一个趋势，同时呢，中国在这个趋势当中有中国特定的问题。 Please.
Thank you. Thank you very much, CLC and NUS, for your invitation. They have taken the opportunity that I am attending the Singapore Summit as well as the MASIC's international panel to ask me to come and so that I can share with you of some of my understanding of urbanization. And today's title is Urbanization, Global Trends and Issue in China. So if you look at this title, it would be that we're looking at the human race's urbanization trend as well as some of the issues that China would face in the process of urbanization.
那么我首先要讲一下这个我关于全球趋势的这一种认识。那么根据最近在中国非常流行的一本书，叫《地球的法则：21世纪地球宣言》当中的有关内容，它把今后若干年里，大概半个世纪里吧，人类有三大趋势，一个就是转基因工程会大面积的推广，第二就是 核动力的广泛使用，第三个就是城市化。所以今天呢，我在这里呢会一开始提到他这本书的一些内容。So
based on my understanding of the trend of urbanization, I'd like to also share with you one book that is, I think, very interesting. And this book is called Whole Earth Discipline and Eco-Pragmatist Manifesto. And in this book, it says that in the next half a century, there will be three major trends that the human race will witness. One would be transgenic, that would be very much an expansion of a transgenic trend. And secondly, would be there will be an expansion of the use of nuclear power. And thirdly, the third important trend, and that would be urbanization.
那么，布兰德先生在这本书里讲。 全球最大的40个城市群居住着全球18%的人口，而这些地区包揽了全球三分之二的产出以及90%的专利创新。And
according to the author of the book, Mr. Stuart Brand, he said that 40% of the urban clusters would house 18% of the total global population. And these urban clusters would account for 2/3 of the global output, as well as 90% of patents and innovations.
那么他预计到21世纪中叶，大致是2050年，我们整个地球上将会有80%的人口，居住到城里来。那么现在大概是50%多一点。那么因此，在今后的很多年里，每年平均全 全人类有七千万人每年从农村进入城市。
And so based on his estimate, by about the middle of the 21st century, which is about 2050, there will be about 80% of the population that will be living in cities. And in the many cities, in the many years after that, every year, there will be 70 million people globally who will move from the urban areas into the cities.
当然这几天我们参加的一个会上有人引用的数据说到2050年全世界大概是66%的人会居住在城里。
But as you know, we have a few meetings these few days, conferences, and there are some people who estimate by that by 2050, there will be 66% of the total population that will be living in the urban areas.
但是这两个数字是不一样的，并不影响我们对今天讨论的一些认识。
And so although the figures may be different, but it doesn't affect our understanding of what we understand of about the trend of urbanization.
那布兰德他做算了一笔账，他说现在大概50%的人住在城里，但是全世界的城市占用的地球陆地面积只占了3%。那么当人口80%进入城市的时候，城市占用整个地球陆地的5%。在大家这个账简单的算数可以知道，它证明了就是城市化有利于人类比较节约的使用土地。
And so based on the estimate that about what we have estimated, about 50% of the urban population would live on about 3% of the earth's dry surface, dry land, and when 80% of the total global population moves into the urban areas, into the cities, then only about 5% of the earth's dry land would be used. And that would also mean that if you use very simple mathematics calculation, with urbanization, in fact, there is a great savings in terms of land use.
那么通用这几条这个论据证明了它一个结论，就是在人类全球化这个城市化的进程中，效率是不断的提高的，同时呢，土地是节约使用的，因此有利于整个地球生态的恢复。
So the conclusion is that with urbanization, in the process of urbanization, there's improved in efficiency, improvement in efficiency, and also there's also efficient use of land, and which also means translates into a more ecological a more ecological use of the entire earth.
当然我引用他这个内容，我个人也是认同他这个分析的。
So of course, you know, the fact that I quoted what is written in the book, I personally actually endorse what he has, his analysis.
那么我们根据中国的统计资料，到了2014年年底，中国大陆呢总人口是13亿多，那么城市居住的人可能是7亿5千万，城市化率呢达到54.8%。
And so, based on the figures, by the end of 2014, in mainland China, the total population will be about 1.36 or 37 billion people, and urban permanent residents will be 749 million, which means that the urbanization rate would be 54.8%.
大家注意到这个数字，如果一会儿还有几个图表来表明，中国是从1978年开始改革开放的，改革开放总到今天已经37年了。那么也就是说，在这37年里，伴随着中国的改革开放，每年是城市化率每年以1%的速度在增长。
So I'll be showing you some diagrams later, but if you know, China started its Gaige Kaifang, which is its reform and opening up since 1978, and it has continued for about 37 years already. And so during these years, every year, in terms of urbanization rate, there's an increase of 1% on a yearly basis.
当然我们可能预计到在今后几年里，速度可能不如前37年那么快，但是到2020年， 中国仍然可以达到60%的城市化率。
So of course, the next few years, the coming years will be not as fast as the first 36 years of 改革开放. But however, by 2020, China's urbanization rate could reach 60%.
那么我们认为呢，中国虽然达到54.8%，超过或者说达到了全球的平均水平，但是相比其他的国家，一些人口相同的国家或者经济水平相接近的国家等等，我们做了各种比较，认为中国的城市化还有很大的空间。
So yes, if you look at 54.8%, and it's more or less the same as the global average, or slightly more. But however you look at the kind of population that we have compared to the other countries that have similar population, similar economic growth, and we have also made a lot of comparison with other different parameters. In fact, China has a lot of room to improve its urbanization rate.
那么这个图就可以看得出来，这个中国的城市化率和日本、韩国、巴西相比，那么中国的城市化率呢还有很大的发展空间。
And so if we were to look at the diagram on the left, the China's it's on the red line. If you compare to Japan and compare to Korea and compare to Brazil, in fact, China really has a long way to go in terms of compared to the other three countries in terms of urbanization rate.
但是这个图也是同样的意思。
Similarly, the other diagram.
那么中国的。因为我今天的重点还是要讲中国有什么特别的问题。一个呢，中国城市化对于37年的改革开放，明显是表现为是一个经济增长的主要动力。所以呢，改革开经济发展促进了城市化，而城市化同时也促进了这个经济的发展。
So of course, my talk here today is to talk about some of the special issues that China faces in terms of urbanization. And in these 37 years of reform and opening up, we saw very fast economic growth. And fast economic growth has spurred urbanization, and in turn, urbanization has also spurred fast economic growth.
当然，中国因为大家对中国的地形如果比较熟悉的话，是西面高，东面低。啊，沿海比这个比较这个人口比较集中，因此中国城市化在全国的这个地版图上面呢是分布非常不均匀的。
So if you know the topography of China, you know that the western region is of course of a higher altitude, and the eastern regions are of a lower altitude, and also you know that most of the population is concentrated in the coastal areas of China.
主要表现为
there's a lot of inequality.
主要表现为东部沿海地区人口比较集中，城市大中城市比较多，而西部就比较少。那么这张图表面，上海是最多的，那西藏是最少的。
So as I've said, you because of the altitude.In the eastern region, where you know there's a coastal area, there will be a higher concentration of the larger and the medium cities, big and medium cities, as well as population. And if you look at the diagram, in fact, Shanghai, because it's an eastern coastal region, it has some higher concentration of urban population, and Tibet would have the lowest concentration.
那么从全国范围来讲，中国的总的来说，这个城市化率呢是虽然达到了全世界的平均水平。但是它的集中化的程度和国际上相比还是比较相对来讲比较低的。
So if you look at China, in terms of the entire China, of course, our urbanization rate is more or less comparable to the global average. But in terms of the concentration of urban population, we in fact is falling behind many of the other countries.
各位知道我在2008年以前，我一直是在中央政府搞政策研究工作。那么在2008年以前呢，我曾经组织过一个由全球的最好的专家组织的一个课题组，做了一个研究。他们得出的结论就是， 对于中国这么一个十三亿人口的大国来说，五百万人口以上的大城市的数量是太少了。
So as you know, I used to work in the central government. I was doing a lot of policy research, and I put together, that was before the 2008. And in during that period, I organized a global study team, and we did a thematic study. And the result was that with 1.3 billion population, China having so many, it's a giant country, to have large cities with more than 5 million people in terms of population. In fact, China has very few of such cities.
那么大家看到这个数字，就是中国五百万以上人口的城市只收获了中国的11%的人口。那么我们相对比的一些国家呢，都是一种新兴国家，或者说叫发展中国家。和这些国家相比，我们的大城市的数量还是太少了。
So if you look at it, the figure on there, China only has 11% of its population living in the mega cities, meaning that the cities with more than 5 million people. And it is actually very much fewer than many of the other countries, whether they're developed countries or some developing countries. We have too few mega cities.
那么这两张图呢，表明就是我们把发达国家也做了对比。那么我们的GDP 的集中程度以及人口的集中程度，和发达国家相比，和发展中国家相比，中国都处于一个比较分散的一个水平。
So if you look at these two diagrams, because you also compared with the developed countries, and if you look at the concentration of GDP, if you look at the concentration of population, whether it's in developing country or developed countries, China's situation is actually very much dispersed, very scattered, not concentrated.
那么我们还有一个做了一个对比，就是中国的大城市里头已经建成的这个面积相比其他国家来说还是比较低的，因此呢这个土地利用的效率还不是太好。
So if you also look at some of other cities in terms of their built-up area, if you compare to the many other cities, our use of these land is in fact very low in terms of efficiency.
大家到中国去旅游就会发现，尽管北京那么大，堵车那么严重，但是和世界上最大的几个城市相比，上海的城市的建成的面积还是不够大的。
And if you have been to China, to tour in China, and if you go to Beijing, Beijing is huge, you know, and despite all its traffic jam, but you compare to all the larger cities in the rest of the world, in fact, the built-up area is still not big enough.
那么改革开放以后呢，我们一直城市得到了很大的发展。我们刚才讲的前面的说的中国的城市集中度，无论从 GDP 的集中度和人口的集中度和国际相比还不够的原因，我个人觉得和这37年来的有些政策是相关的。
So after the reform and opening up, and yes, our cities have developed a lot. But as I've said just now, our concentration of GDP, our concentration of population, is still not good enough. And I think it has got to do with the policy that we have adopted.The policies that we have adopted over the past 37 years of reform and opening up.
因为在中国改革开放以前，中国的政府的主要指导思想是控制城市的发展，这个愿意把更多的居民留在农村去生产粮食，来保证中国人吃饭问题。
So that is because before the reform and opening up, what?Is very much guiding the government is that it tries to control the urban population, stop them from going to too many of them or from going to the urban to the cities, because it wants them to stay in the villages, stay in the rural areas to grow rice and greens to feed the hungry stomachs.
在那个时候，中国的农民是不能允许随便的自由的进入城市的。
At that time, in fact, the rural peasants, we call them 农民, they can't actually enter the cities as they please.
他们进入城市往往需要他居住的所在地的政府给他出具一个证明，他才能出来。
So if they want to enter the city at that time, you know, they have to get the local government to give them some kind of certificate, some kind of proof, and so that with that document, can they enter the city?
当然，改革开放以后，中国发展的市场经济以后，显然这样的体制是不行的，因此呢，必然有一部分农民会转入这个工业。
So, but after reform and opening up, and with China's introduction of the market economy, and we, of course, you know, cannot still stick with such a kind of policy. And so some of, very naturally, some of these rural peasants, they will have to undertake change of profession. That is, they have to move into the industries.
那么当这种由农民自己办的一些工厂出现以后呢？中国政府当时的政策就是叫你可以办工业，也可以不再种地了，但是你只能，当时有一个政策叫离土不离乡，就是你可以离开不种地了，但你不能离开你的家乡。
So of course at that time the government's policy was that okay, now we are having a market economy, so we have some of these rural populations setting up their own factories, having their own industries. And the Chinese government policy at that time was that yes, you can set up own industries, you don't have to plant crops, you know, but the policy is that you can leave the land as in your agricultural land, but you cannot leave your hometown. You must stay within the village, the rural areas.
所以在一九八零年的时候，当时主要是在中国的农民，主要是在当自己的家门口，啊，建了一些我们叫做乡镇企业。
So that was about the 1980s, and some of these, we call them 农民. I think it's easier for you to remember. These 农民 or these rural peasants, they would set up their own little enterprises, you know, within their own townships and their own counties. We call them TVEs, which is Township Village Enterprises, 乡镇企业 TVEs.
那么这个城市化的过程呢，是以非常分散的形式进行的，一直到了这2006年，我们仍然把大中小城市这个叫齐头并进啊，这个尽量控制大城市的规模，基本上是我们中国政府的一个指导思想。
So you can imagine by doing that, in fact, it is a very scattered way of urban development or urbanization. Even up until about 2006, you still have, you know, the big and medium size and the small cities. Going through the process of urbanization, and the Chinese government is actually still very much controlling the urbanization rate of the larger cities.
所以一直到本世纪啊前十年，我们才逐步认识到这种发展方式是非常浪费耕地的，效率非常低的，因为每个产品的形成供应链，它的运输成本非常之高。而且由于污染比较分散，治理就代价极其高昂。
So you can so up until about the first 10 years of the 21st century, you can imagine that there's a lot of wastage in terms of the way they use the land and resources. Also, was not concentrated, and also because of pollution, to deal with pollution, to treat pollution, because it's also dispersed and so scattered, it was also very expensive.
近十年。有在相当的一些城市已经把这个大门打开了，要扩大它的规模，并且欢迎外来的人到这里安家落户。
So in the last 10 years or so, there are some cities that have actually opened the doors in the sense that they will encourage, you know, people from outside to set up homes in their cities.
其实在这个过程中，原来非常分散的那种小企业现在纷纷倒闭了，都集中到城市的附近去了。
So the, as I said, you know, it was originally it was, you know, 改革开放, and then you have the little sporadic sprouting up of the small little TVEs and all that, but later on now, many of them have already closed down, gone bankrupt, and now many of them are aggregated around the cities.
也就是说，在近37年里头，我们的钱差不多20多年，这个路子是不太对的。虽然城市化的进程是在向前走，但是这种城市化的这种政策上存在很多问题。
So I would say during the 37 years of reform and opening up, the first 20 odd years, in fact, we feel that I feel that the road, the path has not been very correct. Mainly also it's because I think many of the problems actually comes from a policy issue.
那么中国呢现在对城市化呢当就是在大力的推行叫城市群的建设和发展。但是就拿这个来说，我们中国最有名的几个经济发达地区就是长江三角洲啊城市群，以上海为中心的珠江三角洲，这个城市群以广州深圳为中心的，那么京津冀城市群是以北京天津，原来过去叫京津唐山啊这三个城市为中心的，那么企图呢还有在这个中游地区，比如武汉啊，甚至于一直到重庆成都这条线啊，形成一个中游的城市群。那么这样呢四个城市群已经达到相当的规模，但是城市群并不能代表一个城市集中度，所以这个城市群的思路提出来以后，我们对比了国际上的其他的啊城市群来比呢，中国的这个集中度还是不够。
So in China, we see slowly with that development, we see the formation of urban clusters. There are actually four main urban clusters in China. We have the Yangtze River Delta Cluster, and then we also have the Pearl River Delta Cluster. And then there's one which is very recent, you might have heard of quite a bit, that is the Jingjingji. Jing is Beijing, and then Tianjin, and then Ji, Hebei. But previously it was called Tangshan. So, and then that would be one, the third cluster, and then of course we have the Yangtze River midstream cluster, which comprises Wuhan all the way to Chongqing and all the way to Chengdu. That would be around the central part of the Yangtze River. So that would form the fourth cluster. So despite, you know, all these clusters forming, but concentration, as I've said, is still very much insufficient compared with other similar cities, similar urban clusters.
那么最近呢，中央政府呢有一个提出了一个新的政策，就是叫京津冀啊联合发展，就是这个京津冀。但是呢，在学术界对这个问题有很多的讨论。
So in fact, recently the central government has proposed that Jingjingji, which is the Beijing, Tianjin, and Hebei region, that they should have a joint development. But however, there's quite a bit of discussion within the academia.
那么提出京津冀这个发展战略呢，其中有一个想法就是北京的交通太堵塞了，这个基础设施跟不上了，想把这些过于密集的人口呢扩散出去。
So the one of the ideas of this Jingjingji development was that because mainly Beijing, you know, Beijing is very populated, very populous, and it suffers from terrible traffic jam, and so the intention and the infrastructure is not catching up with the development of the population. So what it once hopes to do is that with this Jingjingji cluster, you can move some of the population outside Beijing into the Jingjingji cluster.
但是有些专家说，日本的东京曾经也是有过这样的想法，说东京人太多了，想把人疏散出去，但疏散了10-20年以后，发现东京的人更多了。
So some of the experts say that Tokyo has thought about it also, and they tried to do something similar, you know, and try to get some of the people out of Tokyo. But it seems that after that, you know, after 20 years, it seems to be more populated.
那么北京的也有一些专家认为说，这个政策呢很可能达不到目的，因为北京想把人口疏散到三环以外去都做不到，你还想把它疏散到天津去更做不到。
So in fact, Beijing also, you know, people were, seems to be quite pessimistic also, because people don't want, are quite reluctant to move outside the third ring, because Beijing has third ring, fourth ring, fifth ring, and people are not willing to even move out the third ring, so let alone getting them into Hebei or Tianjin.
其实呢, 北京作为, 刚才我前面已经提到, 中国的城市的集中度其实是不够的, 但是城市的规划, 基础设施的配套, 这方面还有很多的问题, 使得一个并不太集中的一个城市显得交通特别拥堵。
And so as I said, the concentration in fact is not enough in China, but because of all the planning, whether in terms of traffic or other kinds of infrastructure, it's not enough. Hence, it feels congested, despite the lack of concentration.
那么中国的这个 集中度这个表格已经看得很清楚了，因为长三角城市群是中国人口最密集的地方，但是和波士顿比，和五大湖地区比，五大湖地区比，啊，北海道的城市群，还有英国的，我做了一个比较，中国的集中度还是很不够。
Yeah, so if you look at the Yangtze River Delta, in fact, the concentration of population or different parameters is not enough, as I've said, but it's already the highest. And if you compare to Boston, the Boston cluster, the Great Lakes cluster in the US, Hokkaido in Japan, England, and all the different places which I've made a comparison, is still very much lacking behind.
当然中国现在呢有一个 交通方式可能会对未来中国城市化产生一个比较大的影响，就是高速铁路的发展，可能会将来更能够优化中国的城市群的空间布局。
Of course, there's one development in China which I think can help optimize the spatial distribution of the urban clusters in China, and that would be the development of the high-speed rail.
大家如果到中国去坐一下高铁的话。 我是最经常坐高铁，我发现除了北京的这个高铁站几乎是建立在市比较市中心的以外，其他的城市的高铁站，它是故意规划在离城市有一定的距离的地方，它是想形成另外一个城市中心。
So I always take the high-speed rail because it's really convenient. And you'll notice that if you go to Beijing and go to China and you take a high-speed rail, other than, except for Beijing, where the high-speed rail station is situated within the city, for the other cities in China, other Chinese cities, the high-speed rail station is in fact deliberately built in a place where it is quite away from the urban center, the city center, so that it is a deliberate move on the part of the government to move some of the, to set up another city center away from the original city center.
我刚才提到，就是全世界的城市的集中度是越来越高。那么，大家会产生一个问题：说高铁交通方便以后，人是不是可以适当的疏散一点？这样呢，大家因为交通比较方便了。但是国际经验表明呢，你交通越是方便，就相当于叫虹吸现象，就是这个管子越粗，和人流越畅，集中度更高。
So I talked about, you know, the concentration or increasing concentration of population and all that, and you were asked this question. So with, you know, with a better traffic, you know, better transport arrangements, would it mean that I can disperse some of the population to different places? And because with the convenience of transportation, but in fact it's not, because if you it's like, you know, if you have a provide a wider channel, you know, for the people to move, and it seems that this wider channel will perpetrate, you know, a greater concentration.
所以未来可能在高铁的交叉点上，会形成一些人口非常规模比较大，这个城市的集中度比较高的一些新的大城市出现。
So because, as I've said, you know, the more transportation nodes and the more convenient the transport is, and you will actually encourage greater agglomeration of people and population, we will find that in many of the high-speed rail transit or railway transit nodes, that you will see cities sprouting up from these nodes.
那么刚才提到中国的城市化主要是七八年，我只有以八零年以来来算。 那么中国的城市面积呢增加了三倍，但是中国城市的人口呢 只增加了120%。
And as I've said, you know, since 1980, China's in the city, the amount of the population has increased by more than three times, more than 300%. The number of cities, the built-up areas of the cities have increased by more than 300%, but the population has only increased by, urban population has only increased by 12%.
那么也就是说，我们有比较多的耕地变成了城市的建设用地，但是并没有带来相应的这么多的农民进入城市。
So, which means that you know you have the land, urban land developing faster than the number of urban population. It means that we have a lot of agricultural land that is being converted into urban construction land. But we haven't, what we haven't done is that the nomin, the rural peasants, sorry, the rural peasants have not been converted into urbanites, urban population.
但是我要准确的讲，就是不是说把一些农地变成城市用地以后，这个地上所有的农民肯定都进城了，但是呢，他们的密度增加的人口的密度不如原来城市的人口密度，实际上这个农民还是这个进城的人还是多了很多。
So of course you have the agricultural land being converted to the urban land, but you don't have so many of the peasants, the nomins, the rural peasants moving into.As many of the rural peasants move into cities, the concentration is not as great. Although, in fact, there are still many of the rural peasants who have actually gone into the cities, despite you know the lagging in terms of the percentage growth.
当然，这个要增加城市的承载能力。刚才讲了北京很堵塞，其实现在北京堵塞的城市是越来越多了。这个你可以列一个很长的这个名单，这个北京这个全国的城市呢。拥堵都非常严重，主要是城市规划和基础设施，还有公共交通没有跟上。
So as we talk about carrying capacity of cities, if you look at Beijing and even all many of the other bigger cities in China, traffic is very bad, and that has actually got to do with urban planning, infrastructure development, transport development has not caught up with the speed of urbanization.
当然这个基础设施呢还是个硬件还有就是交通和城市组织管理的能力没有得到相应的提高因为你们到北京就会发现北京可能有全世界最宽的路有最这个多的路但是北京的交通也是非常的堵塞严重
So in fact we have hardware you know we have the roads and we have the transport systemBut the management ability has not actually caught up with the infrastructure construction. So if you go to Beijing, we have huge roads, wide roads, but we still have very bad jams.
这个北京市的市长曾经专门到香港去学习香港的交通管理，因为大家都知道香港的路是很窄很窄的，人口的密度也比北京高得多，但是它的交通堵塞并不是那么严重。
So, in fact, we have the Beijing mayor going to Hong Kong to learn the Hong Kong's model because you know Hong Kong has very narrow roads, but and then it has very high population density, much higher than Beijing. But it's apparently its traffic jam is not as bad as Beijing.
那么当然，我们城市化当中还面对的一个问题就是我们的基础设施。那么其中包括什么呢？就是要城市用这个。现在 大城市都有的叫地下综合广廊，就是说像北京这种地方，过去呢，经常如果这里有北京长大的人都知道，北京经常是今天要修电路了，把马路挖开了，然后过两天把它盖起来了，过两天又自来水了，又把它挖开了，然后又自来水了，然后过几天又给它盖起来了，再过几天要煤气了，又把它挖开了。就经常挖，那么现在好像大家就发现北京不怎么挖了。不挖的原因是地下有一个非常大的一个管道，可能这个它的截面可能和我们这个会议室差不多，你可以开车，可以各种各样的网线从底下走，就不用再挖马路了。
So we have infrastructure problems, and we talk about, you know, the underground utility lines. If you, those who come from Beijing will know that previously, you know, when they have to repair some of the electrical lines, they'll dig it up, repair it, cover it up. And then if they have water pipelines, you know, leaking, some problems, they'll dig it up, repair it, and then cover it again. And there's some problems with the gas leaks or gas lines, to dig it up, and then they repair it, and they cover it again. So it's a repeated action. But you'll notice now that it doesn't happen so often in Beijing now, because it has a very huge pipe. This entire pipeline is probably as big as the cross-section is probably as big as this room. And so that's why, and it contains all the various pipelines underground.
尽管北京有了这么，当然北京、上海很多大城市都已经有了地下的综合的这个管线了，但尽管这样，大城市的基础设施仍然还是有很多的缺陷。大家都知道，北京的人在马路上开车都会淹死，这个大家觉得很笑话，因为北京是个缺水的地方，居然会一场雨把人淹死。
So we have this comprehensive underground utility lines that is being built in big cities like Beijing and Shanghai, but there's still a lot of problems. There's still a lot of flaws in the bigger cities in terms of infrastructure. And Beijing had a major, it was a very heavy downpour, and the people can die in a flood, in a driving, you know. So it is actually quite ludicrous.
其实北京在地下这个雨水处理上面呢，已经做了很多的工作，大家都不知道，其实北京地下有很多的小水库，就是雨水下来以后，它存在水库里面，然后用。但是那次为什么呢？第一就是雨量太大，它排不干净了。第二呢，北京不是有好多地面这个河流嘛？这河流呢，平时呢，这个园林管理部门呢都要花钱从水库里买了水。 让这个河流有点水，增加北京的美观的程度。但是那次天气预报说快要下雨了，那么这个城市交通部门呢就通知园林部门说，你最好把这个水放掉。那么一下雨呢，我们就把这个水呢抽到那个河里去。但是园林部门呢说，万一不下雨，我这个水放掉以后，谁来花钱再买这个水呢？所以我就不放。所以那次主要其实还是部门协调不行。
So we have drainage system underground drainage system, and in fact the Beijing municipal government has actually done a lot. And you also know that in fact we have a lot of underground water reservoir that is in Beijing that try to store water. But at that time when there was this major downpour, first of all it was too heavy a downpour, and so the drainage was not good enough. Secondly, you also know that in Beijing we have rivers, and these rivers and the forestry authorities, they usually try to spend money to buy water from those underwater tanks, reservoirs, to sort of pump into the river so it looks very nice, you know. So at that time when the weather forecast says that, you know, there's going to be a rain, you know, so you should try and drain up the water so that in the river so that, you know, you can sort of store the rainwater. But the authorities thought, oh no, but what if it doesn't rain? Then, you know, what am I going to do? You know, that wouldn't either spend money buying the water to pump into the river, so it refused to do. And so that's why there was the flood. So again, it's lack of coordination between the authorities.
当然，这个从全国范围来讲，这个雨水和污水的分离，以及污水的处理，以及中水的利用，在这一方面还。
So in terms of, if you look at the entire country in China, the separation of sewage water and rainwater, and the treatment of sewage as well as the use of reclaimed water, I think these are areas that we haven't done enough, we haven't done well enough.
在北京现在如果建一个新楼的话， 城市规划部门已经要求他，这个楼里的生活用水就在本楼里处理，形成中水，然后用于冲厕所。这样呢，就比过去原来是做得好很多。
So, but however, Beijing has also improved in some extent because now when the new building is going to be erected, the Urban Planning Authority would require that it reclaims the water, so that we call them zhongshui, which are actually reclaimed water, intermediate water, and that would be used to flood toilets within, it would be treated within the building. And so in that sense, it has done quite well.
这一页呢，我主要是想讲，我们脱离了产业，这个在讲城市化，那是空中楼阁。因为城市化归根结底，它要依托于产业的发展，所以城市化和产业的发展必须紧密结合在一起。
So when we talk about urbanization, we cannot disregard industrialization. Urbanization requires industrialization. They need each other.
这大家都知道，国际上有很多这样的例子。很多以前以资源为主的一些城市，等资源枯竭以后，这个城市就废弃了。那么最有名的，大家都知道的，美国的底特律，原来是汽车工业的中心，现在底特律，我看，反正我最近没去过，看到照片，简直就是一个完全被废弃的一个大城市。
And so, if it is without industrialization, a city will die.It will rot away, it will degenerate. I mean, if you look at Detroit, it's, in the US, is one example. It was a major automobile center, but if you go to Detroit now, it's a wasted, degenerated, completely degenerated city.
当然中国也有很多资源枯竭以后，或者资源价格下来以后，这个城市走向衰落的。可能大家在报纸上看到最近一个比较有名的例子，就是中国原来生产那个羊绒最有名的地方叫鄂尔多斯，因为那儿有很多的煤，而前一段时间呢，中国经济高速增长的时候，煤的价格很高，所以鄂尔多斯的户就是当地的人的人均 GDP 超过了香港，所以当时盖了很多的房子，现在变成鬼城。
And also, if you there are also certain cities where, the resources has been depleted or exhausted, or when natural resources prices come down, it also affects the development or the well-being of a city, and it also becomes like a ghost city. One of the very famous city would be Erdos, because Erdos is very, very famous for its wool, and it also has a lot of
是煤是吧？是它这个鄂尔多斯是煤炭。
And so it also has a very good coal deposit, but after depletion, and it before that, its average GDP was much higher than Hong Kong, but now it's a ghost city.
这个呢，当然是一些专家写的，也不是我个人的意见。就是基本上城市的布局呢，总是不能离开产业，而产业在一个城市里呢，通常都是一些这个服务业在市中心啊，高科技或者 IT 产业，那么一些重型的。有一定的污染的放在城市外面。
So this diagram is actually not done by me, it's actually done by the experts, but you also see that if the city center, it's mainly the service industry, you will have finance industries, IT industries and all that, mainly service industries, and the more technical ones or the more, those that are polluting industries, they would be usually located outside the city.
那么我在这里顺便说一下，像中国有一个非常奇怪的现象，就是中国的三大石油企业，它都坐落在中国的北京的东二环两边。这个呢，可能外国人是非常不能理解的，因为大家都知道，像美国的石油主要放在休斯顿、德克萨斯州，或者这个飞机工放在这个西雅图，都没有看到这些企业都跑到华盛顿去建总部。原因是北京的教育啊、医疗啊各方面文化设施比较好，更重要的原因就是我们这些企业都是国有企业，你三环边上的土地再贵他都敢买。
So if you go to China, there's a very strange phenomenon that, because I talked about, you know, polluting industries, they're usually located outside the city center, and you only have mainly the service industries located in the city center. But if you go to Beijing, you'll see that the three main petrochemical in these enterprises, they will be situated around the second ring, because inside, you know, within the city center would be the main city center, and outside the first ring would be the second ring road. And so, which is a very strange phenomenon, because if you go to Houston, you don't see the same situation. And if you aeroplanes, you know, you go to Seattle, you also don't see the situation. You don't see them going to Washington. You know, they're located outside Washington and other cities. And the reason is because, of course, part of the reason is because in Beijing, you have better healthcare, you have better education, and basically they're SOEs, state-owned enterprises, and they can buy. No matter if it's a third ring or second ring road, it's expensive, they have the money to buy, and they dare to buy it.
所以中国有很多不能解释的现象, 必须从体制上才能得到解释。
So there are many very strange phenomena in China that you cannot explain, inexplicable. You can only explain it from a policy perspective.
那么今天讲的中国问题当中有一个重要的问题, 刚才翻译呢也感到非常困难, 因为在全世界呢好像没有这么一个词儿能够准确表达, 因为
So, yes, indeed, there's one very strange phenomenon in China which is very hard to explain. I actually spoke to Mr. Li to ask him how should I treat this word, because this term, because China is the only country in the entire world that still have this hukou system, which is called household registration system.
因为我一开始用了一个数据说 2014年中国城市化率是 54.8%， 但是在这个 54.8%的人口当中， 真正拥有中国城市户口的人只占 37%， 因此剩下的人呢， 他是在城里住， 在城里工作， 但是他没有城市里的户口。
So I said earlier that China's urbanization rate is 54.8%. But in fact, those who have this household registration, we call them hukou, there are only 37% who are really true blue urbanites. The remaining of the people, they live in the cities, they work in the cities, but they are not recognized urbanites. They don't have this hukou.
那么有些 年轻的农民到城里来做工以后做的，因为改革开放都37年了，第一批进城的人现在已经很老了，那么有的呢就回到了农村，有的呢他再也回不到农村，因为他很不习惯农村的那种生活方式，所以呢他往往回去以后攒一点钱住在小镇上或者县城里，所以把这些人加在一起，中国真正的住在常年住在城市的只有 45%。
So, and you know, our reform and opening up has continued for about 37 years already, and many of them who have gone into the cities in the first batch, the earlier batches that have gone into cities are actually quite old already. Some have gone back to their old hometowns, their old villages, and there are some, they don't, because they are not used to a rural life anymore, and so they would have saved some money, you know, they were doing their stay in the cities, and they will find, you know, little county towns and stay within those county towns. So those who stay permanently, quite permanently, in the urban regions, about 45%.
那么所以呢，要使这些54.8%的人 都能够获得和原有城市的人同等的权利，同等的福利，那么我们下一步应该尽量的，要尽快的要取消这个户籍制度，让所有能够每一个中国人都能在各个城市和农村之间自由的居住。
So, to really make sure that the 54.8%, including those who don't have the hukou system, as I said, to truly enjoy the welfare of urbanites, we should remove that hukou system as much as possible, as soon as possible, and that's why we call it a citizenization or urbanization, whatever I call it, because it's really a Chinese context kind of word. We call it 市民化. And basically that would mean that these people will have a an official, you know, urbanite status, enjoy the benefits, the welfare of an urbanite, and not live there and not have the welfare of an urbanite.
因此，在今后中国人口城市化率达到70%，是一个什么构成呢？就是现在是37%的城市户籍人口，那么还有18%呢？他是住在城里，但是他没有城市户口。另外，我们还要增加现在不住在城里，还有20%的人口，这些人加起来是达到70%的城市化率。
So as I said, you know, to enable them to have the urban hukou, so that you know they can move very freely, you know, in different parts of the country, the aim is to have a 70% urbanization rate. And what does that mean? We have 37% who have hukou already currently. And then we have 18% of them now who live in the urban areas but do not have a hukou. So these are the people that we try to citizenize them, you know, to give them the urban hukou and to make sure they enjoy the benefits. And we also, with increased urbanization, we want to increase another 20% of the people in urban areas.
那么大家可能会产生一个问题，说为什么这件事不快点做呢？难度就在于因为我们是已经实行了66年的，当然不到66年，因为是50年代过了几年才开始实行的，差不多60年嘛，大概差不多实行了60年的这个户籍制度呢，一夜之间是很难改变的。原因就是现在的城市户口的人和农村户口的人，在医疗、养老、教育等等方面，过去还有粮食。你有没有粮票，对吧？过去还有粮食，现在没有了。主要是在这几个方面，一个养老问题，一个医疗问题，还有一个教育，子女的教育问题。这个呢，城乡之间差距还比较大，让这些人都享受城里的待遇呢。当然我个人认为他享受是天经地义的，因为作为一个中国人，为什么你这样我这样，没有道理的。但是由于这个体制是已经走到60年了，要改变不是那么容易，所以需要一个过程。
So then you say, okay, these people don't have the urban hukou. Why don't we just give it to them? It's so easy to just give it to them. But the problem is that this hukou system has been around for about 60 years already, and it's very hard to change because the people living in the urban areas and the people living in the rural areas, they enjoy very different benefits in terms of OH benefits, in terms of medical health benefits, in terms of education benefits, and in the past even food, you know, the way they give away food coupons and all that. So, and of course you say, you know, they're all human beings, we're all human beings, we're all Chinese, you know, that we should entitle, they all should be entitled to the same rights. But it's hard to change, and it takes a process to change a system that has been in place for the past 60 years.
那么大家如果不是生活在中国，而且不对中国问题不加以研究的话呢，一定会简单的得出一个结论，就是好，那一夜之间把所有的农民都变成城里人，中国问题就解决了。但是我和就告诉你们一个你们想都想不到的一个问题，就是现在一个农民通过考大学、当兵等等等等，或者到一些中小城市，其实比过去已经容易很多了。但是中国哪怕是一个小镇上的城市户口的人，想拿一个农村户口是完全做不到的。
小镇的拿农村户口拿不到，
对，所有城里人，不要说是北京人，假如我一个北京人特别想到某一个农村拿一个农村的户口，是根本做不到的。
So but then there's something we can say, okay, it's very easy, you know, overnight you can change it and give it to them, you know, that hukou. But there's also another situation that is very hard for you to imagine also, you know, because we want to urbanize them, you know, give them the hukou and urban status and all that. And in fact, now for a nomin, a rural person who holds a hukou, he goes to university, you know, graduate from the university, so he will get an urban hukou quite automatically if he finds a job there. Or if he goes to the military, joins the military, or, you know, it's quite easy for them to go to a small, medium town to get an urban hukou. But now the situation is reversed in that it's very hard for someone who has got an urban hukou to get a rural hukou.
所以如果从户口的角度来说， 农村进城里很难，城里人下乡更难。
So we said, okay, it's very difficult for the rural peasants to get a urban hukou. But for a person who has an urban hukou to go back to the village or go back to the rural areas is even more difficult.
这是为什么呢？因为每一个农民他在农村有一份自留叫责任田，这个田是集体分配给他的。如果你外来一个人，他就要给你每一个那地当中要挖出一块来给你，这是不可能做到的。所以农民现在的就是在农村的户口当中也是生了不增，死了不减，就是说这一家的老人死了，他的土地是不减掉的，但是这家生了很多孩子，土地也是不给他增加的，这个土地基本上就分配，当时说三十年不变，后来说五十年不变，后来又说长期不变。所以这个土地制度对中国的城市化也是一个很大的制约。
So why is that so? Reason is because China is collective, in the rural areas is collective land ownership. So they plant their crops and they have their own piece of land for their own homes as well as a small piece of agricultural land that's given to each household and even each individual. So for them, if there's a new person, by right, theoretically, if there's a new person who enters, who has, say, obtained a rural hukou and comes into the village and wants to live there and plant their vegetables or whatever, these people who have already been distributed the land has to each take out one small piece of land so that it is divided by the number of people who live in the village or in the rural area, so and give this newcomer that piece of land. But of course, nobody wants to give it up, don't want to give that piece of land. So the situation is this, you know, if there are new people who are born, you know, there is no increase in a piece of land because nobody wants to give up that piece of land for this newborn baby, you know. And if a person dies, so there's one person less to share the land, the family members also wouldn't want to give up a piece of land. So it doesn't change whether it's supposed to be 30 years, 50 years, and for the long term it doesn't change. And so urbanization, because of this refusal to give up the piece of land in the rural areas, urbanization is also very much constrained by this mindset and by this system.
所以呢，在中国的，因为我今天题目是讲的城市化，我今天是要点一下，就是在中国城市化的过程中，从某种意义上讲，农村正在处于衰败之中。
So my topic today is about urbanization in China. But I also want to touch on a point that in fact the rural areas in China is also going through a phase of degradation.
因为每一个农民他家里有一块地呢，政府就给他补贴，现在给每个农民的补贴加起来，全国对农业的补贴达到一万多亿。那么一万多亿呢，有些农民他尽管已经到城里来了，家里什么人都没有了，但是这块地因为属于他的，他不能会让给别人，因为他这个补贴还是归他的，所以他土地永远就不让。他不让呢，有的是交给别人种，可是现在别的邻居呢也越来越没有人了，所以别人也不种，所以现在农村大量土地荒芜掉了。但是土地呢不能集中，如果土地可以转让可以买卖的话呢，那么你不种可以交给别人愿意种的种，但是他又不愿意让出去，因为他这里面有补贴，所以对农村来说这个体制是有很大的问题。
So what happens in this rural land receives subsidies from the government. So in fact now the annual subsidy exceeds 1 trillion RMB 是人民币是吧？一万亿是人民币是吧？ Yeah, so 1 trillion RMB in terms of government subsidy for these land for agricultural work or agricultural operations. So now, as we know, there are a lot of migrant workers. So these rural people, they will go into the cities and they will work. And in fact, the piece of land is not undertended. But they won't want to give it up because they will want to receive that subsidy from the government. And of course, you know, they can also give it to someone to plant, lend it to someone to plant it for them. But there aren't many people to plant because many people have also, the neighbors have also moved into the cities to work. So that is the reason why many of these agricultural lands are going through a phase of, is going through degradation. And also because they're very much fragmented, because different families, different people own different pieces of land. Some are planted, some are not, some are being wasted away and all that. And so that is also putting a lot of constraint on the agricultural process. And because agricultural land in China cannot be transferred, cannot be sold. And these are all constraints in terms of land use.
那么要解决中国，我的题目当中是中国问题。那么中要解决中国这个城市化过程的几个这些问题，要进行几个重点的改革。我这里呢就点一下，刚才其实我都讲到了，要进行土地制度的改革，要进行财政体制的改革。那么土地制度改革，刚才就讲土地应该让它流转起来，这个其实政府已经有文件，但是做起来还是有点难度。再一个呢，财政体制改革呢，就将来如果成每一个人口能够自由流动的话，就需要建立全国统一的社会保障，包括医疗和养老。那么这样呢，和各地的财政的收入状况就要进行大幅度的调整。那么我这个呢就不讲了，就是列了这么一些表格，一些思路大家都可以看出来。就是说我们要解决中国城市化的问题，要解决土地制度问题，要解决财政体制度问题，要解决社会保障制度问题。
So, I said, you know, we talk about urbanization. We also, my talk also, it's also about some of the problems that China faces in the process of organization. And I propose a few key areas of reform. One would be the land system. As I've mentioned just now, you know, we must allow the transfer of land. Although there has already been some government documents, but execution has been very difficult also. And also there should be a fiscal system reform also, and that is also very important. And so if there is freedom of movement of the people, we also should need a standardized social security system, which includes health, which covers health and also covers old age. And also that would, if we were to do that, and that would also affect the entire use of the fiscal income. And so, to solve urbanization problems in China, we need to look at land, the land system, we need to look at the fiscal system, we need to look at the social security system. This is a package that we have to look at in order to solve some of the urbanization problems that China is facing.
那么如果做到这几点，那么我们城市化呢就会持续可持续的发展下去。那么城市化的过程呢，从两个方面推动今后一二十年中国的经济增长。一个就是有大量的投资，会因为要建设城市嘛，都要进行刚才提到的很多方面的建设。再一个就是当一个农民变成一个城市的市民以后，他的消费方式和消费能力都会很大的提高。我记得在1980年代，中国有个领导人就说，哎，应该让农民进城，为什么呢？他说如果农民进城的话，我们的工业会得到很大的发展。为什么呢？他说农民在农村可能不刷牙，他每个人到农村里来起码要增加一把牙刷，一年就增加好几亿把牙刷。那么农民可能在农村呢，夏天是光脚，他到城里怎么也要买个拖鞋，买双鞋。那农民在家里呢，可能原来是光的不身子，到城里至少要买一个背心。所以呢，这个会大大的这个扩大中国市民的消费能力。
So, these are some of the things, as I said, you know, which will help in the urbanization of China. And there are actually two main areas that I think, if we were to summarize them, there are actually two main areas. One would be increase in investment, because we need to use investment to develop the city. And the other aspect would be consumption, because when a rural person goes into the city and becomes an urbanite, it will change its the way it consumes, and of course its ability to consume has also, will increase also. I remember previously there was a Chinese leader who said that we should let the rural people go into the cities because we need them for industrialization. And he quoted something very vivid. He said, you know, some of them don't brush their teeth, you know, when they're in the village, but if they go into cities, they'll brush their teeth. So we have another, you know, a few hundred million of toothbrushes that would be produced. They may, when they're in the village, they may not be wearing any shoes, but if they go to cities, at least they should wear a pair of slippers. Then we have, you know, slippers production. And when they're in the village, they may not be wearing any clothes, topless, you know, but when you go to cities, at least they should buy some singlet. So there's a change. It's a consumption-driven kind of development.
今天我的时间已经到了。 那么我就到这里来结束我的这个讲演。那么最后呢，我就稍微介绍一下我所在的这个基金会，是中国一个非常有名的经济学家命名的一个基金会。那么这个基金会的主要职能呢，是给中国优秀的经济学家的他的优秀的作品，包括论文和著作颁奖。它已经有了30多年的历史。
So I've come to the end of my presentation. Just want to share with you the organization that I'm from. This foundation that I'm from is actually named after a very eminent economist, and it also does in the past 30 or so years, it gives out awards to very eminent, excellent papers that are written, books that are written, and we've done that for the past 30 over years.
当然，这是一个中国本土的一个奖项。 在中国呢，在老一辈的经济学家当中，他有很大的影响力。但是我到各个城市去讲演的时候，发现现在的年轻的大学生都不太了解了。虽然我看到今天在座有很多来自大陆，但是我相信他的年龄对这个基金会已经不太了解了。So
in fact, this person is a very famous person in China, and it's the award that we got is actually a local domestic award. And this economist, for those belonging to the older generation, would know him very much. He's very eminent and he's actually very influential. But I notice as I give talks in China and move around in China, I found that the younger university graduates don't seem to know him very well. And all of you here, many of you are from the mainland, but I don't think many of you know him.
但是我做了这个理事长以后，我尽力在推广这个基金会，而且不仅在中国大力推广它，而且在国际上大力推广它。到现在为止，已经有三届，大概有4-5个外国人写的英文的论文，发表在国外的刊物上的文章获奖了。So
when I became the director, I tried to promote and make it known, this foundation of ours, and even China, I tried to do that, and internationally even. So for the last 3 years or so, in fact, we have given out awards to 4 or 5 foreigners who have written their papers in English and published in foreign journals.
所以欢迎在座的各位学者。 无论你在新加坡，无论你用中文写的论文，还是用英文写的论文，你都有机会在我们的基金会获奖。So
I'd like to encourage all of you, all the academics, all the scholars here, write, whether you write your paper in Chinese or even in English, it doesn't matter, you will stand a chance to win an award from our foundation.
欢迎大家参与这个。
And you're most welcome to submit your papers.
谢谢。
And to join in. Thank you.
谢谢刚才李建阁董事长做了一个深入浅出的非常精彩的这个演讲。李建阁董事长一直被誉为是国内学者型的管理者，那么在中国国内呢，像这样的前辈，通常尤其我看中央电视台，他们称为老师，所以我今天也称李老师。 李老师呢，大家都知道，曾经于1991年、97年、2001年3次获得过中国经济学界的最高奖，就是森野芳经济学奖。在中国经济学界有着重要的影响力，但是大部分在座的，包括很可能大部分人可能不知道，李老师也曾经在去年前年获得中国医学科学年会上获得了。 中国医学科学领域内的最高奖，那就是中国医学科学技术奖，表彰他为创建中国新型农村 合作医疗制度新农合做出的特殊贡献，为中国亿万农村家庭提供了医疗保险。这也是第一位非医学科学领域专家在中国荣获这一医学这个科学的最高荣誉奖，我们大家为他鼓掌。刚才我说明的这个实际上就是说明李老师他是一个多面型的这个学者型的这个政策制定者，这个也是这个管理者。那么在这个当中呢，他所以就解释了他为什么能够刚才与许多丰富的经验和实力解释了中国城市化与世界全球城市化当中发现的一些特殊的问题。他谈了比如说是中国城市群的这个问题了，还有谈了一些这个硬件和软件发展的问题了。比如说实际上这个我们好像有一种说法，就是说这个中国这个硬件发展还是很快，不光是城市化还有科技发展，但是中国的软件发展是相对落后。比如刚才这个李老师举的高铁例子，就是说在高铁交叉点上有许多以后的高城市群可以发展，但是你看看比如说像美国这样的城市，它是用了知识和文化来凝聚，比如说 Stanford 大学或者是这个 Michigan 大学或者 Berkeley， 他们都在小城市里，然后 Stanford 大学就凝聚出来了一个硅谷这么样一个工业群。所以呢一个呢想看看就是李老师通过你这样的经验，今后有什么这个措施能够使中国的软件这个也跟着迅速的发展。我讲这个呢可能是一个比较难的，因为中国牵涉到大家知道有个体制考核的问题，地方政府的领导干部他考核是用硬件 GDP 作为他的业绩的考核 KPI， 但是软件这个东西你要一辈子以后或者你下辈子才能看得到，所以不改革，这也就是李老师刚才说的这个体制不改革这些许多东西。所以说李老师对中国中央政府或者地方政府今后这个软件怎么跟上去，这个是问题一。问题二呢，李老师大家都知道是金融方面中国的专家，因为他担任过这个包括中金的这个董事长了，然后清华大学国家金融研究院的院长了，证监会的副主席了。刚才李老师提到了但是没有时间展开，就是搞这么进一步的城市化的深化的发展，钱从哪里来？这个金融渠道这个问题看看李老师如果能现在用比较简单的再跟进一下，然后下次有机会我们国立大学和这个宜居城市研究院再次把李老师请过来再继续展开。下面我简单的用英文解释一下不用吧OK， 他大家说不用解释啊。
这个刚才邓教授介绍了我的简历，那我的确呢是可以说在2008年以前呢，我一直是在中央当然更早我当过知青啊，大家北国内来的都知道什么叫知青。我当过知青，然后考第一届考上大学，然后考上研究生，然后在一直在中央政府工作，研究生毕业以后在中央政府工作。所以2008年以前呢，我基本上一直是在中央政府担任官员。
So I've already my background has been introduced by professor, and as you know, before 2008, I've always been working in the central government. In fact, before that, I was a 知青. 知青 means an educated youth, and those who are from Chinese background probably know what 知青 is. But anyway, I went into the university and I got my master's, and after that, I was working in the central government before 2008.
那么2008年以前呢，我主要是从事政策研究，所以正如邓教授说的，就属于学者型的官员。
So before 2008, as I was mentioned, I'm actually more like an academic official because I was doing a lot of policy and political research.
刚才提到的就是关于社会保障，特别是农民的医疗保障，是在我在担任官员的时候，推动了这项工作。
So he mentioned about social security, especially on the health security of the nomin, which means the rural peasants. And when I was a government official, in fact, I was the one who was driving a lot of that.
2008年以后呢，我就到了金融企业。我今天在座的也有原来工作的中金公司的同事在到会来参加这个会议。
So after 2008, and I went into the financial industry, I went into a financial enterprise when I was in Zhongxin, and in fact, I have some of my colleagues who are here today.
当然现在具体的这个投行的工作我没有了，但是中央汇金公司的副董事长呢，目前还是做的。
So and of course, I was also in the investment banking industry, and I was in the so investment banking industries, and also I'm also the chairman, and so this is also something that I've always been doing. Also, I have been doing now.
所以我的人生应该说还是比较丰富的，做学者，做官员，后来又到企业去了。
So in fact, I have I live a very fulfilling life in that I was an academic, and then I became government official, and then I went into the private industry.
刚才提到，好像邓教授集中最后就归结为一个问题，希望我解释，因为由于这个时间问题，就是中国如果按照未来人口有60%甚至于80%的人口城市化的话，要建这么多城市，钱从哪儿来？
So in fact, if I were to summarize Professor's question, because of the lack of time, I would, with urbanization, we want to reach an urbanization rate of say 60% or 80%, and we have to build so many cities. Where does the money come from?
我个人认为的钱其实不是一个最主要的问题。我说了，你们这个也会 surprise 很奇怪。如果按照中国在大城市、小城市、中等城市现在已经建到的住房，大概每一个人13亿人，通通住到城里来，还有很多的富裕。
So, if I were to give you some figure, you may not, you may be very surprised. And we will count all the housing that's been built in the big, medium, and small cities. If you get the entire 1.3 billion population to live in each house that has been built, I think we still have excess.
可惜呢，这些房子建的都不是个地方，就是我刚才提到的，中国的城市集中度太低。那么前几年，中央政府呢，为了解决房价过高的问题，那么就推动了4500万套的安居工程的一个项目。那么这个项目呢，后来我经过一个调查发现呢，就中央政府把这个4500万套的房子的建设任务呢，就分到各个省，然后各个省呢，那个省会的所在地呢，因为它这个土地比较贵。如果把这个房子建在省会的话呢，他政府付出的成本会比较高，因此呢，他就把这个任务呢继续往下分，大概就分到地级市。地级市大家都知道，地呢也相对比较贵，土地也比较少，那么所以呢，他们又继续往下分，就分到县一级市去了。所以我做了一个调研，特别是在那边远的省份，比方说我在前几年，大概有5、6年前，但是我还在中金公司的时候，我到东北的一个地级市，大家都知道地级市就是省市县这一层，叫伊春市，它是中国产木材的一个城市。这个市长书记呢，是从北京分下去的，他跟我比较熟，他说你知道吗，我们这儿的居民都在往外走，所以我们现有居民的房子都没人住，但是中央还叫我们建更多的房子。
So, as I mentioned just now, that the agglomeration of the clustering of the cities is actually quite low, and in fact, for to solve the housing problems, the central government has actually given out a directive that it should build 45 million housing units, which is a special project. And of course, it's being distributed to the different provincial capitals. But as you know, at the provincial capital level, prices of land is very expensive, cost is very high to build. And so it's distributed down to the prefectural city level. And prefectural city level is still expensive, and land is still also very scarce. So it goes down to the county level, county city level. And so it goes further and further out. And so about 5-6 years ago, when I was still in Chongqing, and then I was doing a survey at the northeastern area in China, and there was a prefectural city that's called Yichun City, and it actually produces timber. And so the mayor from the city was actually from Beijing, and I knew him quite well, and so I was talking to him, and he said, "Oh gosh, the residents are all moving out of this city, and the government wants me to build more housing."
那么这个问题当然我要讲起来特别复杂，我只能简单的回答邓教授的意见，就是如果我们中国用市场化的办法来解决这个问题的话，会解决的比较好，而且呢会比较省钱；如果用行政计划经济的办法来管理这个事情的话，会问题解决不了，花很多的冤枉钱。
So because this is a very complex issue and it's very hard for me to go into the details, I'll give a very simple reply, and that if we use market forces, if we rely on market forces to solve the problem, we will be able to solve the problem very well and will actually be quite cost effective. But relying on administrative measures, and if it's the measures of a planned economy, so to speak, then we won't be able to resolve this problem very well and we'll be spending a lot of money.
那么大家都知道伊春是干什么的，伊春原来是中国森林最茂密的地方，是中国木材的主要产地，但是现在森林资源已经枯竭，而且政府采取保护措施，因此那儿的人已经没有工作可做，都离开了这个地方。
And so as mentioned, the Yichun city, it's actually a timber producing place, but because now with the degradation of the forests and people and the government wants to protect the forests and refuse to allow any more deforestation, so the people have no work to do and they just move out of the city.
所以呢，计划经济经常做蠢事。比如伊春这个产木材呢，我又想到另外一个例子。来回答邓教授的问题。
So in fact, planned economy, the measures of a planned economy often does stupid things. So based on the question of what professor has asked me, I thought of another example.
就在三十多年前，中国人呢刚刚改革开放，生活条件好一点。大家都不知道，三十多年前啊，在中国要买这么一张桌子，买这么一张椅子。可能都买不到的，因为中国那时候极其的缺乏，所有东西都缺乏。那么中央政府就想啊，总得要给老百姓家里有个凳子啊，有个桌子啊，有个床啊，有个柜子啊。因此中国应该发展家具工业，因此中央政府就拨了50多亿，在黑龙江建了若干个家具厂。
So 30 over years ago, that was about the beginning of the Gaige Kaifang reform and opening up period. And of course, life got a bit better and people have needs. They need tables, they need chairs, but can't get them. Everything was very lacking. Materials seriously lacking. And so the government was thinking, okay, we need to give the people stools, some chairs, you know, beds, you know, cupboards, tables. And so it decided that, okay, we need a furniture industry. And so the government took out about 50 billion yuan and built furniture factories in Heilongjiang.
因为作为政府的计划经济的官员，他坐在办公室里怎么想呢？说我这个厂一定要建在有木材的地方。但是我现在告诉你，当时建的所有的厂，今天已经全部不存在了。
So, you know, a planned economy, the officials of a planned economy, that's how they think. Okay, now I want to build a timber factory. I want to build a furniture factory or furniture factories. I should be building these factories in a place where timber grows. So that's what they did. But now, if you look at all the furniture factories that were built, they are no longer around.
因为我们以为有木材的地方就可以生产家具，最后发现其实没有木材。但是中国现在家具工业主要集中在什么地方呢？ 恰恰中国现在的家居工业最发达的地方是没有木材的地方，例如山东、江苏、浙江、福建。
So they thought, you know, we need to build a place, the factories in a place where there is factory, where there is wood, you know, for them to chop down the trees. But in fact, if you look at the places where furniture manufacturing is very prosperous and is doing very well, they are located in cities where there is no forest for them to chop down trees, and it's located in Shandong, in Jiangsu, in Zhejiang, and in Fujian.
所以我简单的说，就是市场经济虽然有很多的缺点，但是它比计划经济要聪明得多。
So to put it simply, although there are many flaws in a market economy, but it is compared to a planned economy, it's much cleverer.
所以中国还要坚持改革开放。
So China should stick to 改革开放 reform and opening up.
谢谢。由于时间关系，我想把问题交给下面。Can you state your name and where you're from, and then your question?
我叫李世昌，来自新加坡国立大学李光耀公共政策学院研究生。那么第一个问题就是，中国目前的现状是适合城镇化还是城市化？这第一个问题，因为李克强前几年提城镇化，这几年又不提了，所以我想听听你的观点。第二个观点就是关于中国这个经济的前景，未来五到十年你的看法会不会陷入这个中等发达陷阱？第三个问题就是关于最近的这个股灾跟国家救市，那么国际上都有很多评论。那么前两天李显龙说是因为中国政府缺乏经验，你的观点是什么？谢谢。
我听到了。好，你这三个问题我都听清楚了。这个第一个呢，就是城市化还是城镇化？你注意到我从头到尾没有用城镇化，因为这个城镇化虽然可能翻成英文没有什么太大区别，但是中国人讲城镇化总是隐含的一个意思，就是要控制大城市的发展，多大量的发展那个小城市小城镇，叫城镇化。因为我在体制内的时候也多次参加文件的起草，都想写成城市化，但是官方呢上面的都说你还得要写城镇化，因为很多的官员的指导思想总是认为中国要控制大城市的发展，要控制要发鼓励小城镇的发展。大家都知道我今天讲话的内容，我个人就是始终认为城市化就是要提高它的集中度，所以我不用城镇化，我用城市化。
So for if you look at the translation into English, whether 城镇化 or 城市化, in fact, in English, it's not a lot of difference. 城 is actually town, but 城市 is city. But if when I was in China, when I was a government working in the government, the Chinese mindset was that it wants to control the larger cities, as I was mentioned in my presentation, and it wants to build up and grow the smaller cities. And when we were drafting the document, many of my colleagues were saying, oh yes, we must use the word 镇, town, 城镇, and not 城市. But, and that was because the mindset they want to control the bigger cities and want to encourage the growth of the smaller cities. But I myself, I think that it should be 城市化. Urbanization should be 城市化 because we're encouraging you know, the growth of urban clusters.
关于你第二个问题呢，我都只能简单的用最简单的语言来回答你，就是对未来五到十年中国的经济发展，我保持谨慎的乐观，或者说我不那么悲观。
So to answer your second question about the next 5 to 10 years Chinese economic development, I would say I'm prudently optimistic, or rather I would say I'm not so pessimistic.
所以结合你第三个问题，我就告诉你，前不久呢，我在北京有一个会上讲过一句话，你们可能在网上还能查到。基本上这几句话呢，就代表我要回答你的观点，就是中国的股市，有人说当时说很危险，我说并没有那么危险。那么也有人说中国经济发展会掉到多少多少，中国经济发展很危险，我说也没那么危险。那么危险是什么？我说了两句话，说中国最大的危险是不改革，中国更大的危险是改革往回走。
So, on your third question, recently I was in a conference in Beijing. In fact, I said something, and you probably can read it from the have seen it from the internet. Because there are people who were talking about the Chinese stock market and said, "Oh, at that time it was so dangerous. No, it was in a crisis." I said, "No, it's not so dangerous." And people say, "Oh, China's economic development is already going downhill, and it's really dangerous." You know, I said, "No, it's not so dangerous." And I said, "What is the greatest danger that China is facing?" I feel that the greatest danger that China is facing is that it doesn't reform. That would be one of the dangers it doesn't facing. The second, even greater danger is that it goes backwards, that it moves back from reform.
关于股市问题呢，是我近一段时间里最不愿意回答的问题。
And on the stock market situation is something that I wouldn't, I really don't like to reply in recently.
因为第一呢，它比较敏感；第二呢，永远有人会批评你，因为市场上总有赚钱的和赔钱的。赚钱的高兴的话，赔钱的不高兴；赔钱的高兴的话，赚钱的不高兴。所以我一般不对股市发表意见。
And the reason why I don't want to comment about on the stock market is because, first of all, it's a very sensitive issue. Secondly, and there's always people who are criticizing. There are some people who make money from the stock market and they'll be very happy, and there are some who lose and they'll be not very happy, and there's always people who will be criticizing.
但是在五月二十三号，我在清华大学颁发孙冶方金融创新奖的时候，清华大学呢给我搞了一个相当于记者招待会。
And so on the 23rd of May, I was in Tsinghua University because we are trying to give out the Shun Yefang Financial Innovation Award. And
那么在这个大家都知道，你只要是开记者招待会，就像今天我到这儿做讲座一样，就没有人不会提到股市问题。
And there was a press conference, and you know when there's a press conference, that people will always ask question about stock markets.
所以在场的二十多个记者，你怎么说怎么说，他的问题都是股市。你说我今天不讲股市，他过两天又来问到股市。
And so you know at the press conference, because it was an award ceremony, there's many reporters and 20 of the reporters, and we said, okay, we don't want to talk about the stock market, and they go one round, a few questions, they come back to stock market again, a stock market question again.
但是呢，对股市呢，我从来不对行情发表意见。就是别人问我，股市是要涨啊，还是要跌啊，我永远是不会说的。但是呢，对股市的一些原则问题，我觉得还是应该说的。所以那天有人说，大家注意啊，是五月二十三号，是中国股市最牛的时候。那么有很多记者就问，说这一次的牛市是不是国家牛市？我听了这个问题呢，我觉得我必须回答，因为这是一个常识范围的事情。我说国家牛市的概念十分危险，它是一个陷阱。所以我这几句话呢，当然我还讲了一些观点，就是和这个相关的观点。当时在五月二十三号以后，大概有十多天里，这个中国的各大传媒电这个网站上面都几乎都在登我这句话。
So,what I really don't want to comment is about to predict or to comment on the market situation, whether it's going up or it's going down. But to talk about the principles of the stock market, I'm very willing to. And on the 23rd of May, it was actually a bull market, and the reporters were asking me, okay, bull market, is it a national bull? You know, that we are seeing a national bull market. Then I thought, okay, this is not very appropriate, so I think I need to answer the question because it's a question of general knowledge. And it's also very dangerous, I think, if we do not address this problem, because I think it's a trap that people are falling into. And said I gave my opinion, I gave my 2 cents worth, and for the next 10 over days, in fact, the internet was full of the comment that I made.
我就说股市呢有涨就一定会有落，对吧？涨的时候叫牛市，跌的时候叫熊市。哦，你牛市你说这是国家的功劳，但这牛市以后变成熊市是谁的罪过呢？那你怎么交代呢？所以我说，不管是牛市还是熊市，你不要跟国家连在一起，它是市场的自身的一个规律。
So, because if there's bull, there's bound to be bear.And so if you say it's a national bull and they said because it's the government that is supporting it, then what about the bear market? Who is supposed to bear the responsibility for it? So I said it is actually, whether it's bull or it's bear, it's actually the market trend. It is observing the laws of the market.
那我讲完话以后的大概二十天，整整二十天，中国股市从六月十三号开始就进入下行的轨道。那么在这个我讲话的时候呢，大概有很多人也很不高兴，因为我这个我好像我觉得我就无非是提醒大家，就像大家在喝酒，我说酒少喝点，喝醉的，但是喝得正高兴的人一定不高兴，说啊、哎、你为什么要说不让我喝酒？我觉得现在的大多数人都认为我讲的是对的，有的人很多人说你的这个讲话呢，第一是对的，第二呢是很及时的。因为为什么对当然不用说了，为什么说及时的呢？因为二十天以后股市掉了，如果你说的更早的话呢，别人就忘记了，你如果说的更晚的话呢，正好赶上股市掉的时候呢，人家就说就是因为你说的这个话股市掉了，所以我这个时间还是比较早的。
So after what I've said about you know the bull and the bear market and all that, after about 20 over days, that was 16.June 13 onwards, the stock market trended downwards. And there's some people who are not very happy with that. I say, they said, what should I just say? No, but I'm only reminding you of the principles of the stock market. It's just like, you know, when you overdrink, you drink too much. I say, don't drink too much, you know. And there are some people who will be very not happy. So why do you not allow me to drink? And so, but however, whatever I've said, I think most people believe and think that I'm correct.I'm correct in what I've said, and what I've said is actually in time, prompt in that sense. Why do I say that? Because it came, the stock market came down 20 over days after I've said that. If it had happened earlier, and I've said that, if I said that much earlier, people would have forgotten that I've said that. If I said it later, and then people say, oh, you said it, see, now the market comes down.
So you just said, 外面认为中国政府缺乏经验。我认为这是肯定的。那么现在呢，看来还不是一个仅仅缺乏经验的问题，因为这次救股灾的总指挥和那个最主要的操盘手都被抓起来了，所以这个呢，可能还不仅仅是一个缺乏经验的问题。
So people talk about China lacks experience, you know, in managing the stock market. I think it's not only about a lack of experience in managing the stock market, because the overall commander and the main operator of what happened at that time, they will have all been nabbed.
Yeah,
sir.
Liu 老师你好，我也是来自李光耀公共政策院的学生，感谢您有关城市化的精彩报告。我有一个比较具体的问题请教您，最近国家行政学院有一个课题组又提出了将深圳、青岛、还有大连三个市直辖的这么一个设想，假如说这个方案能够付诸实施的话，我想肯定又带动周边区域的进一步城市化。我想请教一下李老师，您感觉这三个城市直辖的方案的利弊或者可能性在哪里，还有就是对各自所在的省份的影响是什么样的，谢谢您。
我也简单的回答你这个问题。我总的来看，就是中国呢一个城市想发展，要么呢想弄个直辖市， 没有直辖市呢，过去叫计划单列市。这个不管是哪一种思路，总体上还是计划经济的思路。我并不赞成在这个方面做很多的文章。当然中央如果说愿意把几个城市变成直辖市，我也觉得也很好，但是这个不是城市化的关键，因为你这个从根本上讲，你这个还是官本位。我觉得这些城市当然希望变直辖市，本来是个地级干部，后来变成副省级干部，然后又变成正部级干部，总是用官本位来考虑问题。但是是不是变成一个直辖市以后它就能得到发展呢？我恰好昨天刚刚看到一个表格，中国的几个城市，包括长三角、珠三角以及重庆市，我看了一下一个长长的名单，我现在记不住，就是基本上长三角的一些城市，包括苏州、无锡、常州、杭州等等，宁波啊、江苏的和浙江的都算进去。然后呢，珠三角的大基本上都是佛山啊、东莞啊，我就不说了。当然还有天津，唯有重庆市人口是净流出的，流出的规模是300多万。就是重庆市有很多的外来打工的人，但是重庆市的人又出去打工，所以他的人口是净流出300多万。其他的我讲的干这些中，包括这个中等城市，都是人口净流出的，他的人口是净流出的，都是净流入的，这是净流出的。所以可见一个城市变成直辖市并不是决定性的作用。
So in reply to your question, because he asked about Shenzhen, Qingdao and Dalian being a direct municipality under the government. And so the question is, I think that it's not a development of a city is has nothing to do with whether, is not directly related to whether it is a direct municipality under the government. I don't think we should think too much about into that, because I think the people who talk about cities being direct municipality are not, basically, they are thinking from a very official kind of mindset, in a sense that, you know, when you become a direct municipality, some people will get promoted and you have different levels of official titles that you can aim for. And so does that mean that when you are a direct municipality, you can develop? In fact, yesterday I was looking, you know, there was a very long list, I can't remember, you know, there were some cities in the Yangtze River Delta, and there was also the Pearl River Delta that includes Dongguan and Foshan and the Yangtze River Delta. There were many, I can't remember, of Shenzhen, Ningbo, and Jiangsu, and there was also Chongqing. But if you look at it, only Chongqing has a net outflow of population, net outflow of 3+ million people. The rest of the cities are net inflows. Net, in the sense that, you know, in these cities, they have people going out to work as workers, and there are also other migrant workers who are flowing to these cities to work, but Chongqing being so developed, it has a net outflow. So I think whether it's direct municipality or not, it is not decisive in terms of whether it will be able to develop or not. It's not a decisive factor. 2 more questions.
Well, Mr. Li, thank you very much for your comprehensive outlook on China's, you know, urbanization. My question is that, coming to the term of reference, I noticed that in the Chinese urbanization situation, demographic-wise, in the top 20 Chinese cities, more than 5 is in Guangxi, for example. Now, the question is that you find that, you know, why is it that the planning is disoriented in such that one state, one province, it is overriding the other provinces? And the question is that what others would like to know, the question of whether the Chinese government planning and in mind, you notice that when it comes to calamity, contingency is not very well planned. So what is your solution towards looking at the unseen or the unknown factor, whereby you say that you will be very much forward thinking in the sense that vis-a-vis the climate change conditions, which is not as good worldwide, what would be your solution? Thank you very much.
这个问题现在我也没闹清楚，你也不太清楚啊。这个中国政府呢，都有一个比较强势的城市规划部门。那么这个规划部门呢，这个能够决定你的楼房的高度，你的楼房的功能，你的道路的走向，你的绿化的面积等等。应该说，还是有一个比较严格的管理的。
So China is actually a very strong planning department in the sense that it decides on the height and the function of the buildings that you build and the direction of how the roads are being run and being planned and also the greening area. So in a sense that it has very strict planning rules that are imposed.
那么当然这些规划的官员呢，他是否具有很长远的眼光，具有很丰富的经验，这个 也不能保证，因为中国的城市化的历史还是太短了。刚才我提到，真正的城市化是七八年以后才开始的，七八年以前的城市是四九年以前留下来的。So,
but these are government officials who impose very strict measures. But the question whether they look at planning from a long-term view or whether these are government officials that are very rich in experience, and I can't guarantee that they indeed employ a long-term view or they're very inexperienced. And partly also because China has a very short history of urbanization, and true urbanization actually happened after 1978. All the buildings that are being built, and, all the other buildings that are being built before are actually inherited from 1949.
其实前天在这个新加坡，邱教授还主持了一个session，专门讨论在城市化过程中的生态问题。
So in fact, 2 days ago, we were having some discussion, and Seku has also chairing one session, and we especially talked about ecological issues during urbanization.
的确呢，这个人口从农村来到城市以后，会
Hope to see you again. Thank you.
和这个气体的排放。
So indeed, you know, in the process of urbanization, where you have the rural people moving into the cities, there's increase in use of energy, and there's also increase in exhaust fumes that are being emitted.
在这个会上，有一个中国的刚刚退休的一个官员讲的这么一句话，也可能是他在工作当中总结出来的，就是说，发展就意味着燃烧，燃烧就意味着排放。
So at that meeting, at the conference, there was a retired Chinese official who said, and he probably had that conclusion in the process of his work, and he had the same experience. He said, development means combustion, and combustion means emission.
他专门有一个数据我注意到，他说一个人从农村来到城市，他的 各种综合排放，当然包括他穿的衣服也不一样了，用的东西也不一样了，这都带来排放。他的排放大概是一个城市居民的排放，相当于一个农民排放的3倍。
So he gave a figure. He says when a nomad, a rural person comes to the city and lives as an urbaner, he says his overall emission, of course, includes the things he wears, the things he uses, and so an urban the emission of an urbanite is three times that of an rural peasant.
这个我注意到城市化过程中还发生了一个生活方式的变化，当然也随着改革开放现农村现代化的变化。比方说，现在这个农村也是一个二氧化碳主要排放的一个地方。这两天我们到新加坡已经深受其害，就是烧巴的这个雾霾。而中国呢，燃烧这个农作物的秸秆的产生的排放也非常严重。
So, in of course, you know, in the process of urbanization, there's also a change of living style, and also in the rural areas, there's also a lot of modernization. So, there's also changes in the way that is the rural peasants live. In fact, now, if you look at the rural areas, it is also a very main source of carbon dioxide emission. And there's also, I mean, these few days, we are also victims of the haze in Singapore. But if you go to the rural areas in China, they are also burning a lot of the stocks of the crops, you know, after it is being harvested.
刚才我提到了，你们注意到，我说我当过知青，我在农村生活过八年。我当时在农村的时候还没改革开放，那是个农民对一草一木是非常非常的珍惜，根本就不舍得把一根草一根树枝随便扔在路上，都要非常小心的收集到家里，因为他全年做饭烧水都要靠这个柴火。
So I remember I told you I was 要不跟你解释一下什么叫
做、对，刚才解释不完整，就是我们下过乡。
So in doing that, it's a 知青 has a history behind it. But basically, these are the people who are educated, but they have to go to the rural areas, you know, during that period to be trained and to do some work. And so these are the people who would have planted in the done agricultural work. So he was a 知青 for 8 years in the rural areas, and that time there was no 改革开放, no reform and opening up. So, but at that time, you know, the farmers really treasure every leaf, every blade of leaf, every stem that it picks up, and they don't throw it away. They will keep everything, treasure it very much, because that's where the energy of their water, their rice comes from.
那么，我就在想一个问题。那个时候农民的草，这个所有的农作物的秸秆是宝贝，都要这个在就是那个那时候都是集体的生产，要分配这个秸秆的时候经常还打架，你家分的多了我家分的少了还打架。可是现在呢，这个秸秆已经变成废物，也是集中烧，所以现在中国的城市的雾霾包括农村的雾霾都是因为集中在秋天烧这个秸秆产生的。
So I was just thinking at that time, you know, these stalks, stems from the crops are so precious to us, like treasure to us. There's, and also at that time it was collective farming. So collective farming, and you, and when they collected all these stalks and stems, and they will be distributing in different houses, and people actually fight over who has more and who has less. But now people treat it as some waste and they just burn it away. And so in China now, in fact, whether it's in the rural area or in the urban area, and people that's how they we see a lot of haze that's happening. That is because during the autumn season, people are actually concentrating, you know, burning up all these stocks and stems from the crops.
所以呢，其实中国的农村的这个秸秆呢，过去也是烧的，现在也是烧的。不同在哪儿呢？过去是300天当中天天烧，现在是在3天或者10天内通一下子烧，所以就烧了很多的雾霾。其实过去也是烧的。
So in the past we burn, because remember I told you we use it as a source of energy for rice and water. But the past is that because we use it every day. So 300 days, 300 over days, we burn it bit by bit, you know, to cook for us or give us energy. But now they concentrate on the burning in 3 days or 10 days. And that's why we get the haze.
还有个烧的不同啊，因为我记得在农村的时候，那个草一草一木的不好烧，还用风箱把它充分的给它空气。所以充分燃烧没什么烟，现在是堆在那儿烧，所以有很多的烟。
So in the past, every blade of grass and the wood that we have, we try to have it full combustion. So we pump oxygen to make sure that there's full combustion, it's fully combusted. But now it doesn't. So that's why we just burn it just like that, and therefore we have the haze.
我专门问过到农村去了解，我说过去那个农村的这个秸秆是宝贝，现在怎么就没人要了呢？那第一呢，当然他们条件生活水平高了，收入高了，他不烧这个了，他到城里去买煤，或者是买那个煤气，就是液化石油天然气烧。那么再一个呢，他说因为年轻人都不在了，因为要把这个草啊从农田里面打成捆再背到家里来，这是需要劳动力的，而现在农村已经没有劳动力了，所以这个草只能在地里把它烧掉了。
So I went, I actually made this special visit. I went to the village and I said, oh, strange, because it was so precious to all of us in the past, and why is it that nobody wants it now? And one of the reasons, of course, because the standard of living is much better now, and the income is also much better now, and people don't really use it so much because they will use LPG, you know, or coal, you know, for their source of energy. And the other reason is because the young people are no longer staying there. They've all moved out, you know, going to the cities and all that. And so, because you would collect all the stalks and whatever, you know, you have to form it, you have to tie it up in bales and then you have to carry home. And you don't have the people to do it now. And that's why they just burn it in the fields.
所以呢，农民到了城里，他本人的排放燃烧的化石能源是原来的三倍以上。那么他留在农村的那个秸秆在集中排放的时候是原来这个在那几天当中是原来的十几倍的排放，所以当然环境就变得很糟糕了。
So you can imagine, so when a villager farmer goes into the city and he uses fossil fuels and all that, remember I said just now the emission is three times, you know, of that of someone who lives in the village. So this is one emission. And then in the village, those few days, you know, the burning, it's 10 over times more than what it used to be. And so that is why, you know, you have a very bad environment.
这确实是刚才提的问题，我觉得非常好，就是在城市化过程中怎样让环境可持续的发展，能够把生态搞得更好，这是我们面对的一个很大的课题。
So I think you asked a very good question, because in the process of urbanization, we ask ourselves, how do we have sustainable development? How do we ensure that we also protect the environment? Indeed, this is one theme that we should really, a topic that we should really look at very seriously, because this is a very major issue.
最后一个
A last question.
好，谢谢您给我这个机会。我叫朱超，同样是来自国立大学理工公共政策学院的在读硕士。那么刚才您提到，就是在市场化这个城市化过程中，市场经济会有更大的作用。那么我的问题就是，刚您提到会在制度方面进行一些改革。那么在社会保障领域这方面，比如说像医疗保险、像住房，如果是放由市场的话，可能会出现您之前提到过的房价过高，包括现在医疗体制改革也是公立医院的去盈利化。那么如果是由市场化、市场经济去改革的话，怎么样去控制这样一种？会不会再度陷入看不起病、住不起房的困境呢？然后另外还有一点就是，像土地制度和医保制度这些是在中国很敏感的话题，可能是涉及到根本制度的。如果您乐观估计的话，需要多长时间或者一个怎样的路径去改变这些制度呢？姐，
第二个问题是什么？土地制度啊。
乐观
啊。第一个问题呢，就是关于社会保障啊，就是城市场化是否在这个医疗改革当中、住房制度、住房价格的问题，好像就完全市场失灵了。人们非常直观地认为，只要搞市场化，房价都是涨的；只要搞市场化，医疗费用就是高的。其实，这个说法呢，并没有完全得到证明，因为前几年。你都知道，中国政府为了控制房价，采取了很多很多的行政措施，结果房价没搞起来，其他问题出来了。所以你注意到没有？这两三年中国政府的 反而在房地产市场上更加放开市场化了，让市场去解决问题。实际上呢，这个市场化的过程中，要当然要采取一定的这个监管措施，它会自己解决问题。现在你看到这个最近有很多材料讲，日本的房子现在卖得非常非常的便宜，因为是人口老化以后，它供求发生了变化。你想用行政的办法改变这个供求是非常难的。那么当然，新加坡的住房解决得非常好，应该说是相当不错，有90%以上的人能够住的是这个政府盖的房子。我们政府呢也多次到新加坡来学习，但是的确呢，新加坡是一个城市国家，它的经验是不可以在中国完全被复制的。这个是因为中国的这个城乡之间，刚才讲，它这个城市居民的是可以说是无穷无尽的人会往城里走的，当然往哪个城市走是不一定，就从趋势来说，说完全靠政府包下来简直就是没有边的。所以呢，这个可能还得要相当程度上依靠这个市场。我举一个例子来说，北京政府呢想做好事情，就给比较买不起房的人，包括从农村来的一些人盖房子。但是你知道这个房子的预算很低的，而且你作为上海市政府北京市政府来说呢，他不会把最好的土地，比方说长安街的土地去盖这个房子，他肯定是放在四环五环六环以外去了。有人说开玩笑说中国这个北京的六环七环快要到沈阳了。那么如果说你盖得很远的话，其实我那时候在政府工作的时候我就在讲这个问题，其实你用行政的办法去盖这种便宜的房子的话，老百姓啊每天都会骂政府。为什么呢？你叫他到六环去，他的工作是什么呢？可能是二环以内的做早饭的、卖早点的、做卫生的、开电梯的，对吧？那么你呢可能把他的房子翻到六环，他的工资连交通费都不够付的，说他每天上班又没到家就一后半夜还没睡下来，第二天又赶着来上班，所以他天天会骂政府。但是你如果用市场化的办法的话呢，你知道在北京的二环和三环之内有很多房子其实是空着的，因为它租赁市场很不灵活，又是要征税又是要登记又是要什么。如果你把这个再放开一点的话，甚至于像城市里面的很多地下室的房子也是空着的，如果你让市场的原则把这些房子租给一些收入比较低的，但是呢离他工作岗位又比较近的，可以很好的解决他住房问题。所以呢，我如果用中文讲可能讲得更加生动一点，就是说政府对老百姓的这个住房问题到底是补砖头还是补人头。补砖头的办法就是把房子盖到六环以外去，补人头的办法呢就是说我算一个北京市的大致上的房租水平，然后你比较穷我就给你补贴房租，但是给你补贴房租以后你到哪儿租啊是你自己的事情。我当然基本上这个补贴呢让你住得起房子，这样呢就会使得北京市二环三环以内的一些旧房子小房子啊，比这些二手房子大量的释放出来进入租赁市场，其实同样可以解决住房问题。而且这些人呢每天都会感谢政府，因为他每天住的房子都是拿着政府的补贴去租的房子，他每天都会感谢政府。但是如果你政府拿着钱就把这个房子盖得特别特别远，盖到六环以外去，他每天上班都会骂政府。所以我认为用市场的方法来解决比计划的方法要很好很多。当然医疗问题我今天不展开说了，因为时间太长了。
So,
你翻译一下吧。
So in terms of, so your question is about social security being one of the systems to reform so that we can solve some of the problems that we are facing in urbanization. And is there, could there be market failure? There's possibility of market failure, because there are some people who think that, you know, you marketize it, you let the market forces take over, the housing prices, the healthcare prices will all go up, but this is actually not proven by evidence. In fact, in the past years, we have seen that the Chinese government have been trying to control housing prices through administrative measures. And we see that a lot of other problems that in fact surfaced, you know, by doing that. So what the government has eventually done is that it has let the market taken over again so that, you know, market forces can take over and try to resolve some of the problems. And of course, you know, when market forces take over, we also need regulation, because but with regulation, you know, some of the problems can be resolved by the market. If you look at the housing in Japan now, in fact, housing in Japan is actually quite cheap because there is a rebalancing of supply and demand, because as the population ages and there's also a change in terms of supply and demand of housing. And Singapore has actually done very well in terms of housing problems, because 90% of people, 80-90% of people live in government provided public housing. And the Chinese government, you know, has actually sent a lot of its officials to Singapore to try and learn the Singapore experience. But Singapore is a city state, it is not possible to duplicate the measures entirely in China. And we also know that, you know, a lot of people, we can use the word endless number of people, are moving from the rural areas into the urban areas in China. And so you can't, you know, use that kind of housing policies or housing measures to solve the same problem. We need the market forces to come in. You take Beijing, for example. You know, the Beijing government is looking, okay, so many people cannot afford housing in Japan, in Beijing, and including, you know, some of the peasants, the rural peasants who have come into Beijing, and so it tried to build houses for these people. Cheap housing, of course, low-cost housing for them. But of course, then they can't find a good place for them to build the housing, because you can't build them in, you know, the city center, or second or third ring. So it builds way out, you know, the fourth, fifth, sixth ring, and really very far, can build it in Chang'an, Jie. And some people are saying that building housing has already extended to Shenyang already. So that's how far it goes. And that would be the administrative measures to build cheap housing. But the outcome of that is that the people who have benefited from the cheap housing will be scolding the government every day they go to work. Because why? They've been living in the sixth ring. And they're probably working in the second ring, doing what? Selling breakfast to the people, you know, who go to work. You know, if you go to Beijing, you see along the road the people with a lot of carts, you know, selling breakfast to the white-collar workers. Or they could be lift attendants. Or they could be toilet cleaners. But they work in the city center, but they live in the sixth ring road. And they'll be spending a lot of money and time on transport, and they'll be, by the time they reach home, they'll be dead tired, they'll be sleeping, but before they fall asleep, they'll wake up and they'll go to work again. So that's a problem. So if we let the market forces take over, what happens is that between the second and third ring road, there are actually a lot of empty houses, old, small, you know, China, Beijing still has a lot of empty, old, and some hutongs also, where these houses could be made use of, not rented, not used, because the rental market is actually very inflexible. There's a lot of taxation that people have to pay, and so that's why some people prefer to keep the houses without renting it out, and not very properly regulated. And so, if that is the case, then if you let the market comes in and you have good regulatory measures, market comes in, so that low-income people can make use of these unused old small houses, pay less and have it near the office, and that would help them solve the problem. In fact, I could say that, you know, it would be easier for them, rather than to build the houses for them to stay so far away, we could actually give them a subsidy, you know, subsidy by head, so that, you know, we ensure that they can afford to rent a place to stay in a way that it's convenient for them, so that, you know, they'll be thanking the government, because they, every day when they go to work, they know they're staying in this house from a very affordable, that they pay affordable rent because of the subsidy that the government has given to them. And so instead of letting them stay in the six ring road, and they'll be thanking the government by doing that, but if they stay in the six ring road, they have their housing, but they'll be traveling so far to and from work, be scolding the government every day. So in that sense, I think the market forces, market mechanism is much better than a planned economy or planned mechanism.
我估计也只能原则性的回答了，因为我觉得我们一百多年过去了，我们是不是现在每做一件事情还要按照马克思曾经说过的来办，我觉得这个是可以商量的，因为在中国的政府的官方文件当中，关于土地流转问题其实已经提出来了，已经是可以流转了，当然目前是讲的使用权的流转。 而且进一步改革的设想也是有的，所以我觉得我们现在做什么事情可能不能拘泥于一百多年以前哪一本书上说过什么来做，而是要按照怎样有利于中国的发展，怎样有利于提高老百姓的生活来做。
So on the second question, I think I'll just give a very general reply. I don't think we should apply the textbook theory from Marx or whoever that is more than 100 years ago, and that we have to reconsider some of these theories and principles, because in terms of in official documents, in fact, it has already allowed the transfer of land, because, but now transfer is for land use of land only, but there are further thinking in that direction. But however, what I want to emphasize is that it should not be a kind of textbook thinking, so it should not be too fixated in any way. All the measures and all the policies that we think our mindset should be guided by the needs of China's development as well as how to improve the lives and well-being of the people.
Well, thank you, Mr. Li, for sharing your truly valuable insights and experience with us. Ladies and gentlemen, let us put our hands together to thank Mr. Li, Professor Deng, as well as our interpreter, Wan Yi. We would now like to invite Mr. Ku Ding-chai, Executive Director of Center for Liveable Cities, on stage to present tokens of appreciation to our speakers and moderator, and for photo taking, please. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of the lecture. We thank you for your participation. We have quite a few lectures lined up for October, so please stay on tune to CLC mailers and website for registration of these lectures. We will also be seeking your feedback via email and would greatly appreciate if you could take some time to help us improve our lecture. Have a good evening, and we hope to see you again soon. Bye.